Tonight, a young woman charged with extorting money from a government minister appears in court. An incident in Switzerland sparks a debate about what really constitutes rape. The Prime Minister encourages aspiring entrepreneurs to take advantage of facilities available to help them get their business ideas off the ground. And the President of the ICT Association wants government to involve ICT professionals in the development process. A very good evening to you. Welcome to the Friday edition of the DBS News World. My name is Timothy Polion. Our top story, a young woman has been charged with attempting to extort money from Minister in the Ministry of Finance, Dr. Ebeldus Raymond, in exchange for not publishing nude photos. The photos have been widely circulated on the internet, but at a press conference this morning, the minister denied that the photos were of him. DBS's Don Nicholas begins our news coverage.
Minister in the Ministry of Finance, Dr. Ebeldus Raymond, responded to serious allegations relating to him. The allegations also involve nude photos splashed across the social media. They are alleged to be that of the minister. According to reports, a woman has been held by the police in connection with the circulation of the photos. The matter is now before the courts. In a press conference earlier today, Dr. Raymond told the media that over the past few weeks, attempts have been made to extort money from him in connection to those photos.
Over the last few weeks, there have been attempts to threaten me. There have been attempts to extort monies from me through devious means. I have provided all the details and evidence in this matter to the police.
WhatsApp conversations allegedly between Dr. Raymond and the alleged perpetrator were reportedly sent to him, demanding that he pay an exorbitant sum of money and allegedly threatening to circulate naked images of him across the net if he did not comply with her wish. Dr. Raymond says he will not give in to what he described as scare tactics designed to undermine his integrity.
The situation I now find myself is not a unique one in the world we live in today. I know that other persons have gone through similar circumstances, and they have probably not been able to fight back. They have been too scared. They have felt ashamed, or they did not want to open up themselves to the kind of attention that shames victims of such crimes. I want to state clearly that no amount of threats will cause me to turn away from my values as a human being and as a family man.
Dr. Raymond praised the police for their swift apprehension of the alleged perpetrator. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Meanwhile, the 18-year-old at the center of the controversy appeared in court today, where she was granted bail in a sum of $10,000 or suitable sureties. We hear more in this report from Sheffield Gillard.
18-year-old Kashabi Alexander, who from all accounts is a promising student at the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College, faces charges of unwarranted demands with menace or blackmail. The young lady is alleged to have attempted to obtain the sum of $30,000 from Minister in the Ministry of Finance, Dr. Ebeldus Raymond, by threatening to release pornographic images of him if her demands were not met. The story went viral after photos, allegedly of the minister, were posted on social media along with extracts of a WhatsApp conversation. Alexander was eventually arrested at approximately 2:45 p.m. on Wednesday and detained at the custody suites before being formally charged. As the teenager made her way to the First District Court on Friday morning, passersby stopped to catch a glimpse of the accused. The matter was heard before Senior Magistrate Fulcher, who granted bail in the sum of $10,000 or suitable surety. Under Section 223 of the Criminal Code of St. Lucia, blackmail is an indictable offence which, on conviction, can result in imprisonment for up to 14 years. For the DBS Newsworld, I am Sheffield Gillard.
And the talk show host Rick Wayne has weighed in on the matter, suggesting that it is not entirely implausible that the photos are doctored. Referring to past attempts to ruin his reputation using doctored photographs, he's encouraging people to view the case with an open mind. Don Nicholas tells us more.
Talk show host Rick Wayne says it is not unusual for technology-savvy individuals to engage in a process called photoshopping, where body parts not belonging to certain people are attached to them. Wayne says he has been a victim of this unscrupulous practice, where the perpetrators showed Wayne and Prime Minister Alan Chesney riding a horse. Wayne made it clear that he was not speaking in defense of the minister, since he does not know the details of the case. He says he is simply exploring the possibilities.
In this instance, a minister has been targeted. Well, I'm not going to go into a defense of the minister. I am going to say it is very ironic that myself, Laura, and others have been fighting, Catherine as well, in defense of women whose pictures, embarrassing pictures, or having sex, tapes, sex tapes of them on TV, to the extent that we now have laws against that sort of thing.
However, Wayne believes this raises serious questions about the lengths some people will go to ruin the reputation of others. Concerns have been raised about the damage this can do to the minister's reputation.
I am not going to pronounce on whether a picture is photoshopped or not photoshopped. It's impossible to tell the difference. It's irrelevant anyway as far as the law is concerned. What is relevant is the attempt at blackmail and the attempt at embarrassing people on Facebook.
Concerns have also been raised about the ethical side of things, given the fact that Dr. Raymond is supposed to be looked up to as a role model in his capacity as government minister and a married and religious man. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
Still in the first segment of the broadcast, an incident in Switzerland has sparked a whole new debate about what really constitutes rape. This after a 47-year-old man was convicted of rape for reportedly removing a condom during sex without the knowledge of the woman. Don Nicholas takes a look at what the local laws say on the subject.
The 47-year-old was given a 12-month suspended sentence on Monday, according to reports. The unnamed man from France met a Swiss woman on a dating app. On their second date in June 2015, they started having sex with a condom, but the woman only realized it had been removed once intercourse was over. The court judged that the woman would have refused to have sex if she had known the condom would be removed. From the local perspective, police press officer Gregory Alexander, quoting from the legislation, told us what constitutes rape here.
In section 1 to 3 of the criminal code, 123, rape is defined as any person who has sexual intercourse with another, A, without the consent of that other, or B, without believing that the other consents to such intercourse, or is reckless as to whether the other person consents or not, commits the offense of rape and is liable on conviction to on indictment to imprisonment for life.
Alexander went on to explain other clauses of the legislation.
That means you could hold somebody, you could threaten to shoot somebody's child or to cause harm to somebody's child for the purpose of committing sexual intercourse with that person. If the person consents under these conditions, then that is not consent lawfully.
In recent times, St. Lucia has seen a spike in the number of rape cases. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Time now for Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Don Nicholas and this is Street Vibes. Today, the people speak on the subject. What would you say to someone who is about to commit suicide?
What I would tell somebody that is about to commit suicide is pray. Go to church and pray. But it's simple to say, but not easy. It's easier said than done, okay? Pray, surround yourself with positive people, and just give God your life, you know? It goes to me, too, giving God my life, which is important. We need to give God our life, you know, God. He's the one that has make everything happen for us. We must not only seek him when things are good, we must seek him when things are bad. And just surround ourselves with positive people and a good environment.
I would tell them to try to get somebody that they feel that they could talk to, somebody they think that could give them good advice, and then they could go to a pastor or someone they can trust, someone they believe that can help them out and that could have them to go the other road instead of taking it. But taking your life is something very important. You know, it's life is it's sweet, it's enjoyable, trust me, I love it. You know, but then I don't think it's necessary for you to take your life. Anybody could solve their problems, and there are different ways of solving it. And if you could trust somebody, you can go and talk to that person. You cannot trust nobody. You cannot talk to somebody that on the same level if you have to go to somebody who can help you go further instead of going backward.
It's not a good idea. Like they say, taking your own life is not very good. Why would you want to do that? God said to people that you shouldn't take your own life.
If someone about to commit suicide, I suggest to them that there's other avenues they could go to, you know? Taking your life is not always the best situation, the best result, you know? You could always speak to someone. I know there's a hotline, a suicide hotline. They could call that, you know, find out if they could need to speak to someone, because a lot of people are going through depression and stress, you know, that really all they need is just to speak to someone about it. Because most people who commit suicide, I think they deal with an ongoing situation that's been bothering them and they don't speak up about it. So I think what I would suggest to that person is to communicate to someone who they could entrust their thoughts with, you know.
I met a young lady a couple of years back and I saw she walk in the road. She asked for a ride. I didn't really want to give her the ride by Caribbean Cinemas and I reversed. I gave her the ride. And she told me, if you know what I am going to do now. I asked her, what? She said, she's going to take her life. I said, well, why do you feel that you want to take your life, that you did not give yourself life? And then she explained her stories and everything to me. I encouraged her not to do it. I think, and the young lady's living up to now, she's alive, you know? But if you don't, because the thing about it is, if you know me, and you realize that my life has shifted a bit and that's not the way I'm supposed to be, you have to question me. I may not tell you everything, but at least you will have an idea as to what I'm going through. You understand? So I would encourage anyone who wants to do that, seek the Lord first.
This has been Street Vibes with me, Don Nicholas. We're taking you back to the studio.
Thank you very much, Don. You're watching St. Lucia's Television and News Leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5 and Hits 92.1 FM. We are also online and the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, more young people told to consider starting their own businesses, and is technology destroying relationships? Thank you so much for staying with the DBS News World. Prime Minister Alain Chastney is encouraging young aspiring entrepreneurs to take advantage of facilities available to help them get their business ideas off the ground. Successive governments faced with high youth unemployment have been encouraging young people to create their own jobs by opening their own businesses. Don Nicholas reports.
In response to what has been described as the tedious and sometimes impossible task of trying to obtain a business loan, Prime Minister Alain Chastney is urging potential entrepreneurs, especially young ones, to take advantage of the support mechanisms in place that would make it easier for them.
So I agree with Israel. I mean, I've said this a million times, that small businesses are like turtle laying eggs. Okay, lays hundreds of eggs. But only a handful of those actually ever succeed in becoming adults. But the fact is, you don't know which one is going to be successful. Mm-hmm. And as I've always indicated, tourism is a platform to help small businesses, especially in the export market. Because what tourism does, it brings that export market to our shores.
Mechanisms include agencies such as the St. Lucia Coalition of Service Industries and the Trade Export Promotion Agency, TEPA.
Basically, the St. Lucia Development Bank, I've gotten some young people on that board. And the goal here is that the St. Lucia Development Bank needs to channel its lending through separate entities. So let's take TEPA. as an example, who is to take an existing company and help them get into the export market. So if they're going to borrow money from the development bank to do that, the development bank is now knows that the person isn't doing it by themselves. So there's that support mechanism to help them go.
Young entrepreneurship has been held up as a tool that could help stem the tide of unemployment among the youth. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The president of the St. Lucia ICT Association wants government to involve ICT professionals in the development process. Chela Mendez reports.
Lindell St. Vild believes ICT has an important role to play in delivering the government's long-term strategic agenda. In addition to supporting productivity and innovation across sectors, information and communication technologies are also critical enablers of trade development. It's on that basis that the ICT Association of St. Lucia wants to be more actively engaged in development planning.
We have from time to time initiatives announced by various regional bodies, even our government from time to time, about things that they plan to do. And there are times we have things which have been planned or even announced, which hasn't been widely consulted as far as we are concerned.
St. Vild made comments as the association held its annual general meeting on Thursday. The AGM presented an opportunity for the association's executive to engage the general membership of the organization in an assessment of activities over the last year and to chart the way forward for this new year.
It was supposed to be held last month, but it was because of the events of Christmas and our last event in November, it was a little pushed back to January. This event is being held to update members of what we did last year and of our upcoming events we have going forward for 2017.
The association represents the interests of a wide cross-section of people in the ICT sector.
For the most part, they are people who make their living out of providing services to the general community. So they, for example, will build web pages, they'll provide consulting services like I do. They will go to business places and devise systems for them to fix things. It's also people who will connect your printer together to your monitors, to set up networks, to set up firewalls. It's quite a range, quite a wide range.
Last year, the association hosted a number of successful capacity building activities, including a cybersecurity workshop and a digital marketing symposium. The focus for 2017 is on advocacy strategies and approaches aimed at getting ICT factored into mainstream development policy. For the DBS News World, I am Chela Mendez.
In other news, a little under 50 participants in the Sound Waves project have completed Life Skills 1 and 2 courses, productivity enhancement training towards attaining national certification with the Caribbean Vocational Qualification Program. Sound Waves prepares young aspiring artists for careers in the creative industries. The course offered by the National Skills Development Center included focus areas in stress management, teamwork, critical thinking, work ethic, and conflict resolution, among others. The Life Skills course is one of several in a 12-month training program. They include Sound Waves, Transforming Youth at Risk Through Music Project, and is being executed by the Cultural Development Foundation with support from the Caribbean Development Bank, the St. Lucia Social Development Fund, the Department of Local Government, Culture, and the Creative Industries, as well as the St. Lucia School of Music. The project recommences on Wednesday, February the 1st, at the St. Lucia School of Music, at which time students will be tutored in music theory, music performance levels 1 and 2, and recording engineering. Is technology getting in the way of your relationships? That was the subject of a presentation by clinical psychologist Francisca Plummer on Thursday. She was addressing the annual general meeting of the St. Lucia ICT Association. Chela Mendez has more.
In today's technology-driven age, people are constantly consumed and bombarded by technology, and according to Francisca Plummer, if that technology is not used responsibly or a balance not struck between its use and obligations to family and friends, the results could be disastrous.
there must be some balance that, you know, comes with the use of technology. So the technology is there, but we have to make a decision about how we use the technology for our relationships. And of course, technology can interfere, it can hinder, you know, closeness and ties in relationships as well when it becomes a substitute for face-to-face interaction and for being together, which is what really connects people.
Plummer likens technology to a two-edged sword. While it comes with the ability to connect people worlds apart, it is also disconnecting them from others right there in their immediate presence.
Yes, ICT is connecting everyone, and we talk about connectedness and there's social media, and it's very popular. And at the same time, the World Health Organization is increasingly concerned about social isolation and depression. You know, so there is something happening here. We don't want to say that there is a causal relationship, but certainly in a world of connectedness, there's certainly a lack of connection going on, which really engenders a lot of depression and anxiety among people.
Plummer is concerned that technology is making people more isolated as they substitute online activities and interactions for traditional face-to-face encounters. But she's not just aware of the problem, she also has some of the solutions.
Using technology to transmit and to share more factual-based information and to leave the discussion and the relating to personal face-to-face contact. And I think it's really important that we put our phones away when we are with people. You know, sometimes we get lost in it. And sometimes when I'm having a function, I actually collect phones. Because everybody wants the Wi-Fi password. I'm like, no! You know, I'm not giving... always ask, and I think it's to put it away for a while and to make a connection and to really speak to people and to understand where people are at.
Not everyone agrees. In fact, there is research that suggests that while digital technologies are changing the nature of community and the way people interact, it is not all negative. Plummer does believe, though, that there is a lack of empathy when using technology to interact with others. She is encouraging people to see technology as an aid rather than a substitute for true communication. For the DBS Newsworld, I'm Chayla Mendez reporting.
When the broadcast continues in just a moment, St. Jude Hospital delivers two sets of twins. Welcome back to the broadcast. For the staff of the maternity ward at the St. Jude Hospital, 2017 has started with double the excitement and double the fun. The hospital delivered two sets of twins in 2 days in the first week of the new year. The first set of twins was born on January the 5th, 2017, to Tanisha Jules of Grand Ravine, Denery. The bouncing baby boys were delivered at approximately 1.02 p.m. and 1.06 p.m., weighing 5 pounds, 5 ounces, and 5 pounds, 3 ounces, respectively. The nurses were initially expecting a single delivery, but quickly realized that they were dealing with twins. Nurses explained that Ms. Jules did not perform an ultrasound during her pregnancy, and so she too was taken by surprise to learn that she was having twins instead of a single baby. At approximately 9:47 p.m. the following day, January the 6th of 2017, the second set of twins was delivered via cesarean section. However, this time, the nurses had more time to prepare. Mother Arcelia Polia of Piero in VA4 had performed an ultrasound and was eagerly awaiting the arrival of her two bundles of joy. The first baby was delivered at 9:46 p.m., weighing 4 pounds, 7 ounces. 1 minute later, at 9:47 p.m., he was joined into the world by his sister, who tipped the scale at 4 pounds, 6 ounces. Both mothers and their babies have been discharged from the hospital and are all doing well. St. Jude Hospital presented hampers containing baby supplies to the mothers. And congratulations are in order. In other news, all is set for one of the Senusha Hotel and Tourism Association's most anticipated events on its calendar, CHTA Taste of the Caribbean competition. Every year, the national culinary team looks forward to the region's most sought-after event in the culinary industry. As part of preparations for the culinary event, which is hosted by the Caribbean Hotel and Tourism Association, SLHTA will be hosting a national culinary competition to select a new team for 2017. The competition is open to hotel and restaurant chefs who are members of the association. The competition is being hosted at the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School on Tuesday, 17th January 2017, between 9 a.m. and 5 p.m. In 2012, some 23 chefs battled for a spot on the national culinary team. This year brings even more excitement, with approximately 25 chefs registering for the event. Following the official launch of the Nobel Laureate Festival 2017 on Tuesday of this week at the Government House, organizations island-wide are poised to roll out activities which highlight and celebrate the achievements of laureates Sir Derek Walcott and Sir Arthur Lewis. This year, the celebrations will run from Sunday, January the 15th, to Saturday, the 4th of February, under the theme, Celebrating Excellence, Fostering National Pride. On Monday, January 23rd, from 10 a.m. to noon, literature teachers from around the island will engage in discussions on literature, the writer and the work, with acclaimed writer Jamaica Kincaid. The dialogue will take place at the Walcott Place on Chaussee Road, facilitated through a collaboration between the CDF and Curriculum and Materials Development Unit Language and Theatre Arts Department in the Ministry of Education. Additionally, the CDF invites the public to support the Sir Derek Walcott Lecture, scheduled for Tuesday, 24th of January, from 7:30 p.m. at the National Cultural Centre. Professor-in-Residence Jamaica Kincaid, Professor of African and American Studies, Harvard University, will deliver a thought-provoking lecture titled Our Homer, Derek Walcott. Sports is next, and the DBS News World continues with Brian Calixt.
Good evening, welcome to the DBS Sports. We kick off with news on football. Action in the 2016-2017 Veterans Football Tournament returns to the Philip Masley Grounds for the Caribbean Alliance Gold Cup quarterfinals this weekend. Defending champion Sufre Veterans are scheduled to take on Flow Lancers, while in the feature match on Saturday evening, Central VA4 will take on Prophets and Kings. On Sunday, Valley Legends will take on former champions VSADC, while former champions CARICOM Masters do battle against Miku Veterans. After a successful 2016 season, Valley Soccer Academy will continue its 13th season this coming Saturday, January 14th, with regular practice sessions at the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School, Vidbute. Parents and guardians interested in registering their child or ward can do so from as early as 8:45 a.m. through to 1 p.m. at the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School, noting that kids from 4 years and up are accepted. Existing members are reminded of the following training details: from 9 to 11 a.m., 10 years and under; from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., 11 to 17 years; from 2 p.m. upwards, a club. And for the next 3 months, the curriculum will include regular practice sessions and scrimmages at the Catches Comprehensive School ground, complemented with futsal sessions at the Bosejo Indoor Practice Facility and beach soccer at VG. In cricket, former West Indies captain Darren Sammy believes Jimmy Adams is an excellent pick to replace Richard Pybus as West Indies Director of Cricket. In an exclusive interview with St. Lucia Sports Online, Sammy described Adams as very experienced and knowledgeable. The two-time World Cup champion indicated that from working with Adams as a coach, he was a very good manager and communicator. The West Indies Cricket Board confirmed the appointment of Jimmy Adams as its new director of cricket on Tuesday. Adams brings a wealth of experience to his new assignment, having served West Indies cricket in a variety of positions. Sammy was removed from his position of West Indies captain last year, said, quote, "I believe he will have the actual cricket and its development at heart," end quote. Sammy, who left St. Lucia earlier this week, will participate in the Najigo Super 50 clash against the West Indies under-19s. Sami will then proceed to Pakistan, where he will captain Peshawar Zalmi in the Pakistan Super League. The charismatic leader went on to conclude that, quote, implementation of his ideas, that's Jimmy Adams' ideas, will all depend on how the big boys at the board endorse or support him, end quote. Don't go away. We'll be right back with more sports news. Thank you for staying tuned. Striker Diego Costa has been left out of the Chelsea squad to face Leicester tomorrow after a dispute with a coach over his fitness. The Spain international has not trained for 3 days and has not travelled for the Premier League's leaders' match with the champions. The news comes amid reports he is the subject of an offer to move to China that would be worth £30 million a year. Costa, 28, has scored 14 goals and provided 5 assists this season. Chelsea declined to comment. And finally tonight, with British number one Johan Konta won the Sydney International today with an impressive 6-4-6 victory over Agnieszka Radwańska in Australia. World number 10 Konta broke a Polish opponent in the third game and hit 18 winners to 5 in the first set. The 25-year-old dominated world number 3 Radwańska with some stunning returns and powerful hitting, and she convincingly won the second set. Konta finished the match off with an ace to claim her second WTA Tour title. And Britain could yet boast both the women's and men's champions in Sydney, with Dan Evans defeating Andrei Kuznetsov to reach his first ATP Tour final, while Jamie Murray is in the doubles final. Konta, playing in the city of her birth, did not drop a set all week as she marched through a high-class field. Now to our thought to take you through the night. God gives every bird its food, but does not throw it into the nest. The DBS News continues. Please stay tuned.
Finally from us, on the lighter side. An Oregon man's no-day cleaning session wound up producing a $1 million prize when they uncovered a nearly year-old lottery ticket. Jamel Panissa found the unclaimed winning ticket just 8 days before the final deadline while cleaning his office on a snowing day, according to the Oregon Lottery. Panissa said he bought the Mega $1 million ticket on January 13, 2016 and placed it in an envelope, where it went forgotten for almost a year. He remembered reports of an unclaimed lottery ticket on the news and rushed to claim his $1 million prize on January the 9th, 8 days before it was set to expire on January 17th. The Oregon Lottery said Panissa, was the fourth Mega Millions $1 million winner since the game began in 2010. If he had failed to claim his prize on time, the money would have been sent to Oregon's Economic Development Fund. Time now for the usual reminder. A young woman charged with extorting money from a government minister appears in court. An incident in Switzerland sparks a debate about what really constitutes rape. The Prime Minister encourages aspiring entrepreneurs to take advantage of facilities available to help them get their business ideas off the ground. And the president of the ICT Association wants government to involve ICT professionals in the development process. And that's the broadcast. Thank you so much for watching and listening to the DBS News World. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Timothy Polian, wishing you a very good evening and a pleasant weekend. Good night. See you next time.